You're on Meet the Press. Senator John Faulkner is a widely respected Labor Party elder. When he talks, the party takes note. But will it listen to advice like this?
It's time for the party to realise there is more amiss here than any one individual can be asked to shoulder the blame for. It is time for us to realise that we have significant problems as an organisation and we must resolve them.
Well, Daryl Melham has been a branch member of the Labor Party for 37 years, and for the past seven he's been the chair of the Federal Caucus. He's represented the Western Sydney seat of Banks for 21 years, and it's welcome back to the program, Mr. Melham.
Good morning, Paul. The last time I was here, I had black hair.
Well, I did have hair once. Just going to that sound grab of Senator Faulkner, it's widely taken that he was referring to the fact that changing leaders isn't the answer to the problems that the party has. Just going to that point, Julia Gillard, a year down the track, has in all the polls figures as bad and in some polls worse than Kevin Rudd. Do you think the party's got the message from John Faulkner that changing leaders isn't the answer?
Well, it's not a message from John Faulkner, it's actually a message from the people. It's a message from branch members, and it's a message from the recent result in New South Wales. I mean, when the New South Wales Labor Party changed Maurice Yemmer, took him out as Premier, a two-party preferred Labor vote was 48%. At one stage during the election campaign, the primary Labor vote was down to 22%. So changing leaders is not the answer. Anyone that, you know, goes for that solution, they're kidding themselves and will be punished electorally.
So the logic there is that Julia Gillard is safe?
Well, no, in my view, look, it's self-evident that we don't know what's going to happen to tomorrow. But if people are talking about changing the current leadership of the Labor Party, then we're headed for certain defeat. It's not Julia Gillard's problem, it's the Labor Party's problem. She's the first among equals in our caucus. She went to the last election, we have formed government. And in many respects, I think the government that we now form gives us opportunities that we wouldn't have had if we were a majority government. It gives us an opportunity for a process where our rank and file are involved, where our caucus members are involved, where they become part of the process together with the Greens and the Independents. And it's actually a tempering of what in the past has been excesses by majority governments of whatever political persuasion. When John Howard had power in the Senate and the House of Representatives in 2004, that was his death knell. We saw the real John Howard and work choices. So something that he harboured all his life, Labor reform, he implemented it and he was rejected.
Can I just clarify what you were saying there? Are you saying the message from the people, the fact is that it was a mistake to roll the leader, to roll Kevin Rudd?
I'm not saying
and
that at all, Maurice. No, don't verbal me. Don't put words
well,
in my mouth.
It sounded like exactly what
at
you were saying.
At the end of the day, you need to command majority support in the federal parliamentary Labor Party to become leader of the Labor Party.
Mm.
Now, I've been involved now with seven leaders of the Labor Party in the 7 years I've been there, and I've been loyal to all of them. It's a matter for caucus to decide. Caucus made a decision. I'm not going to revisit it, but the electorate had an opportunity between the change of leadership and now to make a determination. Now, there's no point in going backwards.
And you've gone backwards.
Marius,
the message from the people,
Marius,
what's your assessment?
It is not. If anyone wants to attribute it to the leadership of the Labor Party, they are wrong. People out there are exercising their powers. There's no doubt that the leadership change was traumatic, not on just members of the Labor Party, on members of the caucus, and on members of the public. That's a given. I mean, there has been a number of leadership challenges in the 21 years I've been in the Labor Party.
It was traumatic? Was it productive?
No. At the end of the day, a decision was made. Now, at the end of the day, the Liberal Party went through trauma as well.
Sure.
They went through three leaders in Labor.
Was the decision productive?
At the end of the day, it's a decision I accept. At the end of the day, we are a democracy. If you can't command the majority support of your colleagues, then whether it's the Liberal Party, the Labor Party, or indeed the Greens. I note the Greens had a ballot for deputy leadership. We found out about it after the event. Sarah Hanson-Young put her name up. She thought she should be deputy leader. She got one vote. The Greens party room decided, move on. Move on. History will deal with that matter, but if we are looking too far backwards, it's over.
Mr. Melham, Senator Faulkner made a number of points about culture in the party and about participation in the party. Now, obviously, the government has a big announcement looming in relation to the Malaysian deal, the asylum-seeking deal. Now, I imagine as caucus chairman, you would like to see that agreement go to the caucus and be validated by the caucus before it's publicly announced.
Well, Catherine, that would be something novel because it's never happened in the 21 years. Let me answer the question. It's not automatic. Some decisions are ratified by caucus before they're made. Other decisions have been made by the Hawke government, the Keating government, and indeed in opposition before caucus has a decision. That's why we have a cabinet. The cabinet, in effect, is the engine room of the government. It should be a process that does come to caucus for caucus's view.
Well, exactly. Given that the left has articulated a list of concerns with this agreement, and there's quite a lot of disquiet around the caucus, as you know, presumably you would think that this particular deal should have the assent of the caucus before it goes, before it's publicly announced.
Look, my view is that's a matter for the leadership. It's a matter for the relevant minister. We have confidence in our leader. We have confidence in our cabinet processes. I've been there for 21 years. The problem for some of the newer people is that they think that everything should come to caucus before it's announced. That's not the way it works. That's not the convention. That's not the history. People will have their say at relevant stages of a particular process. Sometimes it's before an announcement, sometimes it's after. That's the history of the party.
Well, the official briefing after the last caucus meeting was that 20 members spoke up and quite passionately about the livestock exporting. What is the mood now? Is caucus going to exert itself more fully going forward?
I think it's very important that caucus has a say, and I've had a number of discussions with Julia and her staff, and she's facilitated changes that I've brought about. I drafted changes in the last parliament under Kevin Rudd, and he and his staff facilitated it. And we had to modify it because there's a minority government at the moment. And I've been very hard in relation to the caucus rules and the caucus processes. So I expect caucus to have more and more of a say. I believe that if you're elected to caucus, then you have an opportunity in the party room, not in the public, to put your position.
Thank you very much for joining us today, Daryl Melham. And thanks to our panel, Catherine Murphy and Marius Benson. A transcript and a replay of this program will be on our website and on our Facebook page. Until next week, goodbye.